Well, good morning and God bless you. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, you can do better than that. Let's give the Lord a good, hearty hand of praise. We greet you in the name that is above every name, and that is the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, where every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Have I got a witness? Amen, amen. I want to welcome everyone out to Abiding Truth Ministries and those that are joining us by way of social media. We're so glad that you have tuned in with us on this wonderful Sunday morning. We're located here on the corner of 57th Street and Washington Avenue, good old West Philadelphia, and we invite you to come out to worship with us in person every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. Amen, amen. This is a good day, and the reason it's a good day because the Lord made this day. Doesn't matter whether you're up, down, in, or out. It's the day that the Lord made. So therefore, if he constructed this day, then we can give him praise, glory, and honor because he's a good God and worthy of all the praise. Well, you beautiful black people, happy black history. Not just happy black history month, but happy black history. It's just a good thing to be black and beautiful. Amen, amen, amen. So many that are in need of prayer. We certainly want to keep the Yancey family in prayer on yesterday. We said our farewells to Bishop Doug Yancey, a very near and dear friend to myself, our family, and the Abiding Truth Ministry. So we want to certainly keep them in prayer. We can continuously keep the Evelyn Graves family in prayer. Some of the generals have been called home to be with the Lord that they have preached about for so many years. And certainly, keeping our finger on the pulse of the social scene, we want to keep the family of Dante Wright. You remember the young brother out in Minneapolis that was shot and killed by the ex-police officer, Kim Potter. And what a travesty of justice that she was just lightly slapped on the wrist by only giving her 16 months. And it certainly should have been a lot more than that. But sometimes they call upon those crocodile tears that plays on the sentiment of the jury and or of the judge. And sometimes when they have a complexion connection, sometimes it makes all the difference. Even though this judge was Asian, in America, everything is black or white and sometimes green. So even those that may not be white, sometimes they want to stay in the good grace of those that are. So they will just capitulate and just do the wrong thing. And you figure in the same town, same county, same court, back in 2017 when Officer Muhammad Noor, just by the name you know he's not of the Caucasian persuasion, he accidentally shot and killed a white woman. And they gave him 12 and a half years, threw him under the bus. You know, no questions asked. The chief of police, they distanced themselves from this brother of color. We heard recently that there was a resentencing, overthrew that injustice, and I think he's now looking at four and a half years, which certainly he would get time served, so it's a good possibility he may come out on June of this year. So still, you know, the wheels of justice turn exceedingly slow, that sometimes it's moving so slow at a glacial pace, we can barely see whether it's really moving at all. But to God be the glory that he has not forgotten us, he has not forgotten his people, and he will continuously be with us to make sure that we get freedom, justice, and equality. If you can't say amen, say right on, power to the people. We've been in on a series of messages under the general title, You Can Run, But You Sure Can't Hide. Why don't you look at one of your neighbors and say, you can run, but you sure can't hide. And this has been a very interesting series of messages that we can relate to. We can call upon the experiences of Jonah and find a little bit of Jonah in us where we're running from the presence of the Lord. We're running from what he's commissioned us to do. We're running from his presence because we know that he has the tendency of sometimes telling us to do something that we just do not want to do. Amen. And Jonah decided to run from the presence of the Lord, go to Tarshish as opposed to Nineveh. We remember how the Lord loves him so much that he troubled his world. You know, sometimes when we find trouble that comes from the Lord, we ought not to think that it is his wrath or his judgment. Sometimes we ought to see that it is his grace and his mercy that he has not consumed us. But it's his grace and his mercy that will trouble our world, slow us down long enough so that we can come to our senses and say, Lord, I am so sorry. And that's what he did with Jonah. He prepared a fish. We discussed those things, and the fish just gulped him up when the men threw him overboard. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now, you know, it's, you know, we all have had experiences of staying at hotels, motels, whatever the case may be. And there are some that are really the upper echelon, 5+ stars, if you will. Then there are some that you'd probably just want to just keep on walking by. Just imagine 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale. And we discussed some of the phases that he probably went through, because there's three basic stomachs of the whale, and there's 3 days that he stayed there. And Jonah just had quite an ordeal, but it was out of the belly of hell, as he described it, that he began to cry unto the Lord. Well, I guess all of us, when we find ourselves in a mix, in a mess, and just in a quandary, we find ourselves extra religious. Our prayer life increases, because now we're having some calamitous thing that has been imposed upon us by ourselves, to the point that we're saying, you know what, Lord, I know I've messed up. You know, so Lord, please forgive me, help me. And the gracious part about God is that he hears us when we pray. And he's so merciful. I mean, sometimes his mercy not only endures forever, but sometimes his mercy seems to be incomprehensible, because our mercies have a limit. You know how the scripture, Jesus speaks that we ought to forgive our enemies 70 times 7? And some of us are so legalistic that we want to multiply 70 times 70 and say, okay, you got 490 times to mess up, and 491, I'm going to get you. No, it's a figurative language to suggest that it's infinitum. It should just go on and on and on. And I don't always want to forgive my enemies. We don't always want to forgive our enemies. Sometimes we want to hurt our enemies. Sometimes we want to exact our righteousness on our enemies. Sometimes we want to tell the Lord, turn your head for a minute, because I know what you're about to say, vengeance is mine. No, this time vengeance is mine, saith me. Have I got a witness? And we find this element in us, but God is so gracious as to forgive us and remind us how many times he's had to put up with our mess. I wish I had a witness in here. And Jonah now is crying out of the belly of the fish. And we pick up our story in chapter 3. Verse 1. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time. What second time? Because now the fish, at God's behest, vomited Jonah out onto dry land. Jonah is now a free man. Now, you know, when it comes to inmates, the recidivism rate, or the rate of return, they come out and they go back in, is extremely high among people of color. And the system in America has it such that you stay where you are, take away your voting rights and everything else, you're no longer a significant member of society, even though you may have paid your debts. That's just the belly of the fish that we're living in this place called North America. And now the word of the Lord comes to Jonah the second time. How many as parents say, listen, I done told you before, I'm not going to tell you again. And then if we have to tell them the second time, woe is them. Well, listen, it should be the first time I told you what to do and you didn't do it. It's not going to be a second time. I wish I had a witness in here. Doesn't mean that you don't love your child. You love them so much that you're going to correct them, because you know you've been around. You've been here before. I know sometimes our children think we are so stupid, so dumb. We don't know anything. We can't see the handwriting on the wall. We can't see their facial expressions. We don't know anything. Because they have us pegged as Ancient of Days. We're just too old and decrepit. Listen, you know you're old when you're only in your 30s and people look at you, children look at you as being old. Or if they call you OG. I must be talking to the wrong crowd today. Here's what the Lord says to Jonah. Arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. Now, just because you were hard-headed, just because you invited trouble into your life, just because you're going through difficult times that you have brought upon yourself, it doesn't mean that God has changed his mind and what he commissioned you to do. He's still going to sit right there on his lofty throne and wait for you to come to your senses. Maybe after you knock yourself upside that big head for the umpteenth time, you just might realize that his ways are better than my ways. And now that Jonah has been vomited out of the belly of the whale, now God says to him the second time, now get up, boy, and go do what I told you to do. God hasn't changed his mind. And guess what? I think after this experience, Jonah realizes God ain't playing. So Jonah arose and went into Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. You keep in mind that Jonah did not want to go and preach to the Ninevites because he knew, number one, that God is merciful. And two, if I preach to them what God tells me, he just may forgive them. And listen, the Ninevites were a sworn enemy of the Israelites. If you look at Nahum chapter 3, verse 1, it speaks about Nineveh as a bloodshed, a city of blood. They were known, according to the scholars, for taking their enemies and skinning them alive and hanging the skins on the city wall. Their wickedness came up before God. And one of the reasons that scholars suggest that perhaps Jonah didn't want to go preach to the Ninevites is that five of his brethren were murdered by the Ninevites. Well, that may be a good humanistic reason for why all of us might use the excuse, I don't want to go preach to the Ninevites. Because if you've murdered someone that's near and dear to me, I don't want God's mercy to be bestowed upon you. In fact, I don't even, listen, I won't say I, because somebody's going to take this out of me. You don't even want them to be incarcerated because you've already got your plot and your scheme together how you're going to exact revenge. Listen, everybody know Bumpy and the boys. Everybody got a Bumpy in their family that say, listen, I'm going to take care of it. You guys act like you don't know what I'm talking about. You might be Bumpy or Bumpette. And that's the thing about it. We know that there's just certain things in us that we don't have similar to God. We're saved. We're growing by his grace. We know that old things are passing away, but we don't always want the old stuff to pass away because we want to retain just enough of the old me so that when I need to take care of business myself, I'm going to take care of it. And that's the part of all of us that we should be afraid of, that there's some element in our life that has not yet been redeemed, that has not yet been sanctified, it has not yet been consecrated, and that is the very part of your life that can cause you to go nowhere slow, it can cause you to walk in a circle, it can cause you to be at a place where you just don't know what to do, so then you strike out on your own, and all the while the Lord is saying in his word, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, all things pass away, behold, all things become new. So you have to see that in yourself and say, Lord, I've been running for a long time. And the message comes back. You can run, but you sure can't hide. Where are you going to hide from the presence of the Lord? He's omniscient. He knows everything. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time. He's the Alpha. He's the Omega. He's the beginning. He's the end. He's the A to Z, the jot, the tittle. You can't run and hide from God. We can hide from one another, but not from God. So Jonah gets the message the second time. Arise, go to Nineveh. Whether they murdered your brothers or not, whether they are idol worshipers or not, whether they are a bitter enemy to the Israelites, it doesn't matter. God says go. This time Jonah arose and he went to Nineveh. according to the word of the Lord. Now, Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey, had about 120,000 plus people. And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey, and he cried and said, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." This is the message, because the wickedness of Nineveh had come up before the Lord. So God is now sending his ambassador to say, listen, in 40 days, I'm going to overthrow this city. Now, Nineveh was really a flourishing city. It was the capital of the great Assyrian Empire in the Babylonian, the Iraq, the Mosul area of today. And they boasted of many things, you know, like any other superpower. You want to retain your power, and power will only concede to power. You can't always just beg for it. You have to, you understand what I'm saying? So now, just imagine what Jonah must have looked like. He's been 3 days, three nights in the heart of the fish. He's passed through the pre-gastric, pre-digestive areas. He probably could have been half bleached white, which was the opposite of his color, because of the gastric juices inside the belly of the whale. His clothes may have been half digested. Seaweed still might have been about his head, as he described. I mean, can you imagine someone being vomited out? Now there's a mixture of what was in the belly's whale, and you come before the Ninevites and say, "Believe God. Let the Lord do to you what he's done to me." You know, sometimes it's not based on what you look like. It's just the fact that you are willing to avail your mouth to the glory of God. And some of us have some big mouths. Some of you, before you got saved, you were a party animal. You were buck wild. So now that you're saved, it is no time to be high sedidian, you know, just praise the Lord. No, you know, if you don't like noise, you are not going to like heaven. Heaven describes a bit of a noisy place where angels are worshiping God 24/7. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, which is, which was, and which art to come. And the 24 elders that are seated round about the throne, they begin to cast forth their crowns and worship God. There's going to be a noise. There's going to be a party going on in heaven. It's not a time to be quiet, because can you imagine, after all the Lord had to do to save you, to save me, to reach us, that's no time to be quiet. We want to say, Lord, I want to thank you throughout eternity. I want to wrap my everlasting arms round about you and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for rescuing me just in the nick of time. Thank you for interrupting my regularly scheduled program of sin and showering with your grace and your mercies. So the people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed the fast. Lord have mercy. They got serious. When you start willing, listen, when you're willing to push food aside to get God's attention, to show your contrition, you're serious. Sometimes we have habits in our life that haven't gone away because of prayer. Prayer is a good thing, but there are some things that have become a stronghold in your life. Some things are generational curses. Some things are familiar or family spirit that requires prayer and fasting. I'm not talking about the kind of fast where, you know, well, I'm accustomed to having 3 meals a day, so I'm going to cut back to 2. I'm talking about water and any medication that you must take, and that's it. Not an amen in the place. No hands waved, nothing. We love the Daniel fast, right? Because it's really just you're eating healthily. You're eating things that are more salubrious to your body. But just water? And some of you, maybe water and a mint. Sugar-free. So Jonah is now, all of a sudden, he's obedient. What made Jonah go from disobedient to obedient? What made him go from just telling the Lord, I don't want to hear nothing, to now he wants to hear everything? It was his affliction. Sometimes affliction in our life is a good thing and a God thing. Sometimes the pain that we felt from our father or our mother's belt, it didn't seem to be pleasant at the time, but look at where you are now. Amen. So here we are. The people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed the fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them even to the least of them. For the word came unto the king of Nineveh, which is like the president, and he arose from his throne and he laid his robe from him and covered him with sackcloth and sat in ashes. In Old Testament, New Testament biblical times, this was a sign of humility. This was a sign of repentance. This was a sign of a contrite heart. Listen, from the greatest to the least, this wasn't as if the king is going to exempt himself. He realized, yes, we are idol worshipers. Yes, we are contrary to Israel, which are the people of God. We're in a place where God is pronouncing, listen, just the mercy of God allows them a chance to change. God is not just a God of the second chance. He's the God of another chance and another chance and another chance and another chance. And some of us seemingly have exhausted our level and our decree of mercies. And so, but God still forgives us. Even after you have sat down and you have thought about doing wrong, got up and executed the wrong, some way, somehow, the God that we serve is so merciful. Sometimes I can't even comprehend why he's so merciful to those of us that are just made of dirt. Our breath are yet in our nostrils, but yet God is merciful. His mercies endure forever. And for that reason, we have to allow his character to overshadow our character so that we can exude mercy from our being. So when someone have done us wrong, when someone have stepped on our toes, when someone have just offended us, that some way, somehow, we have to find mercy in our soul and say, Lord, I still forgive them. Lord, I love them. I'm going to pray for my enemies. I'm going to do good to those that despitefully use me. I'm going to do everything that you would have me to do because you are going to be merciful to me. Sackcloth. He went from his robe. He went from being heavily clad to put on sackcloth. Oftentimes it was made from goat's hair. Many times it was black, which was also a symbol of mourning. You know, years ago, the women used to have the veil over their face when they went to a funeral. That doesn't happen as much now. Some traditions are compromised. You know, how many folks remember when we used to put the wreath on the door, symbolizing death? That was a good sign for the thieves to know, okay, they at the funeral. I wish I had a witness in here. Some things we just don't do anymore for whatever reason. So now the king has declared a national fast. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and the nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink water. Lord, have mercy. Some of us would have said, how long? Because we want to know. And sometimes that part of you that just want to know and need to know is the problem in your life. Because, listen, we live by faith. It's not to say that we don't use our God-given intelligence or all that you have gained through your matriculations through universities of higher learning. Yes, we take all of that and we submit it at the foot of the cross and say, Lord, I'm still going to acknowledge you in all my ways. I'm not smart enough to even know what's going to happen 5 seconds from now. So, Lord, all that I am, all that I ever hope to be, I'm still going to lay it at the foot of the cross so that you can lead me and guide me every step of the way. And not ask you how long, because sometimes the Lord will tell you to give up something and won't tell you whether he's ever going to give it back. I'm going to say it again because I don't think most of her. Sometimes the Lord will take something from you that's near and dear to you and won't give you any indication whether he's going to give it back. If he spoke to you and said, listen, come off of social media for 30 days. Just lost half the congregation, right? What? I can't do Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram? Not what? How many folks wake up and don't raise your hand and die. But I wonder how many folks wake up and the first thing you look at is Facebook. Everybody got their self-righteous look on, like, read my Bible. Yeah. Sometimes that's the first thing I do. Not all the time. I go through seasons. The amazing thing is how I find out who passed away. Now let me see if I raise a hand. How many folks the first thing? Once you indict yourself, everybody feel at ease. Let's turn this corner. So now, nobody drink anything. Why? Because the king realizes we have a chance to be the recipients of God's mercy. Judgment has been pronounced. It's going to happen. These folks are familiar with the history of Israel. They know what God did against the Egyptian civilization. Listen, their reputation precedes them. So the king does not want to take a chance. Nobody do anything. Don't drink nothing, not even water. Lord, this is serious. But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. Sound like he became a preacher overnight. Who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from his fierce anger that we perish not? Listen, in other words, what do we have to lose? We're the greatest empire of the then world. That they were the America of their day at that time. Well, when you reach a certain position of power, sometimes you feel as though, well, y'all, you all, not me. Mm-hmm. The king, something about the word of the Lord that came through Jonah's mouth that struck him, and he believed God, and his people believed God. Well, if you really believe God, you got to demonstrate something. If you really love the Lord, it has to be demonstrative. It just can't be in words. It just can't be, well, you know I love you, because we all can say it. We all know the script. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God is good all the time. We all know this, but how many folks are living a life in a demonstrative way that you can measure their love for God? Don't tell me you love the Lord and you barely read the word. Don't tell me you love the Lord and you never fast. Don't tell me you love the word and you never share your faith with anybody or somebody, if not everybody. There are certain things we do that are fundamental to our belief if we ever are to become true ambassadors of the kingdom of God. And Jonah is speaking to us. And God saw their work, that they turned from their evil way. And God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. There was some pending judgment for every single one of us. I've said it a million times behind this sacred desk. I know I deserve to go to hell for some of the things I've done. There were some things in the 51 years I've been saved I have never testified to in public. I might tell you how Rick, my former old head from the gang in South Philly, I'll tell you all the stuff he did. But that it goes to show you God's grace, how he just covers us. Lord have mercy. Some things are too embarrassing even to talk about. It's covered by the blood of the Lord. Oh, long forgotten about. But there is a message to you and I out of the book of Jonah as well. He speaks to his church. He speaks to his body. He speaks to those of us that represent the kingdom of God. And he says, go into all the world and make disciples. Go and preach. And it's the very thing that the church seemingly doesn't want to do because, well, you know, we have all kind of connections and I don't want to offend this person. And, you know, I may not be as inclusive as I ought to be. And we tell God we're not going to go in certain terms. And the Lord sometimes will cause trouble in your life. But here's the bad part about it. Sometimes you don't even recognize the trouble. Sometimes you find yourself moving forward. You seem like you're still progressing. You're still getting things to happen for you without even realizing you're going nowhere. Slow, and that's worse than going nowhere fast. At least if you went nowhere fast, you're back at the same place in a speedy period of time. But when you're going nowhere slow, it seems like you're making progress, but you really aren't, because God called you. He placed a high and holy calling upon your life. He's given gifts in your life. He's given you talents, and there's something specifically that he wants you to do, and it is out on the street. We thank God that we can come here. This is almost like the boxer's stool in between rounds. We get out there, we do battle, we preach forth the
word of God, we go into dangerous situations. Then we come in here, we refuel, we get back together again, and we go back out. And many times we have to look at people as if that is you. You have to put your face on somebody's shoulder and realize, Lord, I need to have compassion for that person. I need to feel sorry for them. I need to say to myself that I'm holding the truth in my bosom because you're the one that endowed me with this power from on high. I can't be tough in church and say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And then I get out there and I'm afraid. I'm afraid of the brothers when I see six brothers heading in my direction. Are they going to rob me? What are they going to do? No, at some point in time in our life, we got to rebuke the fear that is in our life and say, perfect love casteth out all fear. And we can't give God any excuses. I'm not saying just run into dangerous situations, but when God leads you by his spirit, then God will protect you. The Lord will be with you, because there's a whole lot of folks out there that's waiting to hear, thus saith the Lord. They're worshiping all kind of idols. They're worshiping false gods, but you believe in the true and living God. He's the one that saved you. He's the one that redeemed you. He's the one that changed your life, and he's changing your life. So now he takes you and he says, I want to throw you out there into Nineveh. I want you to go to Nineveh and preach the word that I give you to give to them. Don't be afraid of their faces, like he said to Jeremiah, but go in the name of the Lord. And we ran in the opposite direction. Lord, I want to go to another conference. I want to go to another seminar. I want to go to another rally. I want another revival. I want all the stuff that is keeping me safe among the brethren. When the Lord says, how much do you need to eat? In church today, we got a bunch of fat sheep. We take in the word on Wednesday. We take the word in on Sunday. We're eating a lot of the word, but we're giving out very little in proportion to what we're taking in. So after a while, we can barely move. All we're waiting for is another wow type of sermon. But at some point in time, you got to realize you've been living in a fish's belly for a long time. You may have decorated it. It may look nice. You done made it smell good, but you're still in the belly of the fish until God says, I will hear you when you cry out. When you cry out in repentance, I will hear, saith the Lord, and I will extricate you out of your situation. And not only will I bring you forth, I'm going to crown you with my loving kindness and my tender mercies, and I'm going to put you back on track and tell you to go and do the very thing I told you to do. You can run, but you sure can't hide. So God be with us. Help us to not run from you, but to run to you. The same way the deer panteth after the water brooks, help us, O Lord, to pant after you, that we can exalt you above our situation, our circumstance, that we can put you first, that we won't prefer ourselves first and fit you in when we have time. But help us to look at the life of Jonah and realize that it was unnecessary troubles that he heaved upon himself, and to some of the things that we have heaved upon ourselves because we're running from you. We're not answering the call. We're not answering the commission. We're not doing those things that you have told us to do. But today we say we are sorry. Please forgive us. Put us back on track. Restore those things that we forfeited to the enemy so that we can proclaim boldly that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, that no man, no woman, no boy, no girl, nobody can come to you but through the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank you in advance for being merciful, hearing our prayers, forgiving us, and restore. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. And maybe those of you that are watching by way of social media, maybe you have been running from the Lord for a very long time. You know it, and God knows it. Maybe you've been backslidden. You once were in his grace. You were once doing the things that he commissioned you to do, and then something happened. The cares of this world may have driven you in the opposite direction. Whatever the situation is, this is your day. The day is this day for salvation. All you have to do is believe in your heart that the Lord raised him from the dead. Believe that he's born of a virgin. Confess your sins. Simply, something very simple. Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. And help me to live for you. And if you have said those words or anything similar to that, the Bible says, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. That means you're saved. Now you have to live for the Lord. There's some Ninevites that he's going to prepare you to talk to. But start in your family, Jerusalem. Then spread out, Judea. And then Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. And listen, if you're not tied up on any Sunday morning, 10 o'clock, we invite you to come out to worship with us in person, 57th Street and Washington Avenue, just about a half block north of Baltimore Avenue. We'd be so glad to see you, and let us know that you saw us, heard us, watched us, and we'll be so glad to have you. So once again, let's give the Lord a hand of praise as we welcome our praise team to minister to us in song.
Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap,
thank
everybody.
You, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Come on and give the Lord a hand clap.
Thank you.
How many people know we're going to call him up and tell him what he, what you want? Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Come on, let's give the Lord a praise.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God.
Number 9.
Hallelujah.
If you confess the Lord,
sing a little acapella song for you. We're gonna do. What if God was unhappy with our praise?
Hallelujah.
Would you change the way you walk? Would you change the way you talk?
Hallelujah.
What if he was unhappy with the way we live?
Thank you, Jesus. Thank
what if?
What if God is unhappy? Hallelujah.
What if again?
What if God is unhappy with the praise? What if he is not pleased with the words we say? What if he takes away his love and his spirit from above? What if God is unhappy with the praise? What if God is unhappy with the way we live? What if he is not pleased with the way we give? What if he takes away his love and his spirit from above? What if God is unhappy with the way we live?
We must
change the way we walk. We must change the way we talk. We must live a life that's pleasing to our King. We must read God's holy word. Let his praises be heard. Lord, just be pleased with our praise. We must change the way we walk. We must change the way we talk. We must live a life that's pleasing to our King. We must read God's holy word. Let his praises be heard. Lord, just be pleased. Lord, just be pleased.
Hallelujah.
Lord, just be pleased. Lord, just be pleased. Lord, just be pleased. Lord, just be pleased. Lord, just be pleased
with a praise. Thank you, Father God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord another hand of praise. Hallelujah. To God be the glory for the many wonders. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Just want to welcome everyone here today and just thank God for bringing us through another week. And happy Black History Month. Of course, this is something that we have to celebrate every day, and not just in a month, but we give God the glory. And as we are celebrating Black History, just giving honor to God for the many wonderful things that he has done for us. just to honor some of those that God has called as we call forth Elder Tim.
Today, our Black History Moment will highlight the life and legacy of former Pennsylvania Senator Hardy Williams, one of Philadelphia's own. Amen. Amen. The late Hardy Williams was born in 1931, a son of the late James and Frances Williams. He was a graduate of West Philadelphia High School and attended Cheney University before transferring and graduating from Penn State, where he became one of the school's first African-American basketball players and went on to captain a championship team. Hardy Williams was also a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania Law School and a member of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. He held the office of second lieutenant in the U.S. Army, serving during the Korean War. He was honored with the National Defense Service Medal, the Korean Service Medal, and the United Nations Service Ribbon. Hardy was one of Philadelphia's brightest stars. As a talented, brilliant role model and trailblazer, he mentored and inspired many. He had an honest passion for justice for his people. He thoroughly understood the assertion of Frederick Douglass that power concedes nothing without a demand. He wanted people to understand that you cannot complain about your government if you don't demand anything from it. As a community activist, he used his voice and politics to make demands on behalf of people who felt that they weren't being heard by their government. It was that desire to empower those who believed they were voiceless that formed much of Senator Williams' political and community activism. Hardy Williams was elected to the Pennsylvania House of Representatives and organized the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus in 1972 and served in the House for 5 terms. He went on to win his Senate seat in 1982 and served there until his retirement from elected office in 1998. He was also credited with creating a multicultural political movement through his 1971 campaign for mayor of Philadelphia, which increased the city's consciousness of his presence. Hardy Williams used an inclusive strategy that brought all Philadelphians together as he mounted what many considered the first credible campaign for the city's highest office by a person of color. Amen. Considering he did it without the blessing of the city's Democratic Party machine, it was further evidence of the senator's political independence. His political punch for mayor was not personally successful, but the dent and threat he posed made it possible for Mayors Good, Street, and Nutter to stand on his shoulders and step into office. Senator Hardy Williams brought his concern for the people into the halls of power without missing a beat. With an independent voice of the people, he was an effective advocate and was highly respected in the Senate. He indeed was a tower of strength. Senator Williams helped to create a collection of community organizations, including the Crisis Intervention Network, Black Families Incorporated, the Urban Economic Strategies Task Force, the Organized Anti-Crime Community Network, Blacks Networking for Progress, and the 8th District AIDS Task Force. His legacy not only continued with the many doors he opened for other people of color, but a school was also named in his honor, the Hardy Williams Mastery Charter School at 5400 Warrington Avenue in Southwest Philadelphia. In biblical times, God always provided a ram in the bush and provided his people with a viable, anointed, and appointed successor to the leader. Moses first, then Joshua, his assistant. Elijah first, then Elisha, his assistant. Senator Hardy Williams first, then Senator Anthony Hardy Williams, his son. Let us all stand to our feet and put our hands together as we welcome our community activist, Voice for the Voiceless, Muscle in Harrisburg, Senator Anthony Hardy Williams of the 8th Senatorial District of Philadelphia and Delaware County. Let us welcome him.
Well, that was a surprise. Sorry. All right, I'll get it together. I want that that manuscript. That was extraordinary. Thank you so much. You know, I get to travel to a lot of churches and speak to a lot of folks. And I will confess a sin today. I really like your church the most. I walk through the doors and your pastor, like, you know, sometimes people warm up. He apparently doesn't have an off button. He's just like right at it, right? And his delivery, I mean, his intelligence, his wit, his knowledge, his information, his passion for Christ is obvious. But I'm going to say this to all of us who are here today. You know, we are here on Sunday doing what we should do as Christians, but Monday's going to come, and Tuesday's going to come. And unfortunately, in Philadelphia, there'll be probably another tragedy or homicide, somebody gets shot. The significance of a pastor, a family, a church here in this community is that we had not left. They were loud for you. They're not really loud for me. I mean, the significance of this church is that you have not left. Christ did his best work not in the temple, but in the streets. And so I want to make sure that you understand I'm not here about necessarily government or me or politics or anything. My father, and he transferred that value to all of his children, was if you are given certain blessings and fortune and grace, then it's your responsibility to continue that on. And so mine just happened to be leave corporate America and join public service in that regard. But I chose this neighborhood because this is the neighborhood I grew up in. This is the neighborhood that got me through gang warfare. This is the neighborhood that got me through all sorts of tragedies, all sorts of circumstances. This got me through drug addiction, heroin, all those kinds of things. These folks here made me what I am today. I have a degree in economics, I have a background in business, I have all sorts of things that have been blessed upon me, but therefore it is my requirement to come back and share that in the neighborhood that blessed me. So the comment for me today is very simple, that if we are going to be about God's business, Jesus' sacrifice, his testimony, then that means on Sunday when we are stored up, on Wednesday when we are stored up, when the pastor said that it is our responsibility to share, then that means forget, regardless of your clothing, your position, your power, your money, the reality is that we have stored up in us something that many people don't. That is the salvation of Jesus Christ and the power of his redemption to save all of us regardless of our sins or our circumstances. That means, yes, that young boy on Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday that you're going to see on a corner with jeans around his butt that doesn't necessarily look friendly, it is our responsibility to find a way to carve into his heart some compassion for his mankind. This church, this pastor is an activist. He's not just a preacher, he's an activist. He's given us direct instruction today that Sunday comes, but so does Monday. And Monday means the power of Jesus Christ should be shared beyond these walls. My father was not Superman. He was just a man. He was a great man. He was a great dad. But when we had gang war in West Philadelphia, some of y'all remember that. Some of y'all might have been part of that. We had the creek, the moon, all that was out here. All was around here. Somehow, my father, Benny Swans, a bunch of moms got together and said, you know what, we're going to do something about it. We're going to join together. We're going to go out in the corners. We're going to talk to these young people. We're going to get them off the corners. Philadelphia was the leading nation of homicides by gangs in the country before Crips and Bloods. We were it. In a year and a half, you know what we went from? Number one, to zero. That's not the power of my father. That's not the power of Benny. That's not the power of mom. That's the power of who? That's the power of who? That's the power of who? So on Monday, I hope that as we celebrate Black History, and you have graced me, so I cannot tell you how much you've touched my heart. I wish my wife was here. I wish my kids were here so I could brag about it, but they're not, but neither are. I will tell you that Monday, I remained as fired up as he did when he left this earth, but I cannot do it alone. Christ had not just disciples, he had people who believed in him before other people made it popular to believe in him. Understand, he was crucified on a cross because of his viewpoints weren't popular or were threatening. I'm asking all of you not to walk up with somebody with a gun. I'm not telling you to be crazy. What I am telling you, though, is be thoughtful. Don't turn our backs on them. Don't think we've lost a generation. And if there's a moment and a place where you think at a septic stop or at work or a supermarket, in a moment where they're sort of bending over, you can see them kind of trying to figure this out, that's when we step in. That's when we step in. That's when we bring the heat, Pastor. That's when we bring the heat, right? In the knowledge and the wisdom and the grace of Jesus Christ. There's nothing more powerful than the grace of Jesus Christ. You know, and I'm closing, you see a senator here, and I appreciate that, but the truth is I want you to see something else. I want you to see a sinner saved by grace. I want you to see a young man who was only married 5 years because he was selfish, ran around, acted all stupid, and made bad decisions. Now you see a man who's married 27 years and 28 years going on August 24th. Have not missed a beat. What you see is a cancer survivor, a person who was going to die because they were diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer kills you in 6 months to a year. I'm 11 years cured. God is good. Let me tell you something. If I can stand here at this pulpit, carry on some of the work that his generation did, just some of the work, and I wasn't the smartest kid, I wasn't the brightest kid, I wasn't the most gifted kid in my family, my sisters and brothers were. If God can lay upon me some level of responsibility and I can have a modicum of impact, I trust that all of us as a legion of armies will change this neighborhood, will change this city, will change this state, will change this country. God bless you.
Amen, amen. We're so grateful for the life and the legacy that's been bequeathed you, that's been passed on since 1998. He serves and serves extremely well. So as not to hold you any longer, you notice he has a birthday coming up. So I think we ought to just honor him. Let's stand to our feet and honor our senator. And these are the words that we never know. We wish you a happy birthday when it comes on the 28th. God bless you. God bless you.
I want y'all to know, not only the best part about this cake is it's zero calories.
And no cholesterol. Amen. So we hope when this birthday comes that you'll have an absolutely awesome, awesome time in some way, somehow. That when your birthday comes, that you'll just have an absolutely awesome time, and you'll find some time to just break away, you and the family, whatever the case may be, because this is hard work. Once you're thrust out there, you're committed to stay out there. And he's faithfully served this area and Delaware County for all these many years. So we thank you so very much. We honor you, we love you, and we respect you. Amen. The church is also happy because since the pandemic, I only preached for a half hour. I would have never thunk it in a million years that we can start at 10 and be done by 11. So let's stand to our feet. I think we have a few announcements. One, for those that wish to give your offering, you know, the ushers will be in the back. You can drop your tithe off of your offering. Go to our website for those that are familiar, atmchurch.org, and it will prompt you the Vanco way of giving. Also, this afternoon, it's a possibility that Jesus might come. So you want to be ready, just in case he shows up. Amen, amen. I believe there is, we are going to play this afternoon, 6:30, down at the Walnut Street Theater, Sherlock Holmes. And if you do not have a ride, you can see Pastor Juanita afterwards, and if you need any money, see our senator. Let's raise our hands unto the Lord. Father, we thank you once again for this time spent in your presence, and we pray that if there are any needs represented here, that you will touch every single person, meet all of their needs based on your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Healing for the body, healing for the mind, we decree it in Jesus' name. And Father, we pray that even as we leave this place but never your presence, that we will always give you praise, glory, and honor as we love on one another. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. See you next week. Be safe.